It's time for this week's episode of Brandon's Sports Talk, featuring in-depth interviews from those who are trending in the world of athletics. And now, here's the host of Brandon's Sports Talk, Brandon Pate.
Right.
Welcome back to Brandon Sports Talk. In today's episode, I have the privilege to interview Ezinne Nwagu, who used to work with the New York Mets as the guest relations. How are you doing today?
Good. Thanks for having me. Really happy to be here.
Thank you. Can you talk about how you knew that you wanted to work in professional sports?
Sure. It's funny. I'm very energetic person, not the kind of person to sit at a desk from 9 to 5. So I always knew that if I was going to do something, it would have to be something where I was out and about, interacting with people, doing different events, and something to keep me interested. And I always enjoyed sports, watching with my dad and participating. So I figured if I was going to enjoy it on the back end, then why not find something within that industry that would, you know, keep me for a lifetime and keep me interested and entertained. And here I am.
Can you talk about, of course, what your time was like with the game day operations as an intern for the Maryland Greenhawks?
You're taking me way back. So that was back in 2010. I actually lived in New York at the time. So every weekend, it was a minor league professional basketball team. And I would travel down to Maryland every other weekend or so. It was a good time. It's pretty much like, you know what you say about when you work in the minor leagues, you pretty much get a hand in doing everything. That's pretty much what it is. So we were there helping tear tickets for folks to come on in. We were setting up the gymnasium because we were in a high school playing basketball, and it changed every location every other week. We were hanging signage. We were the hype men. On a slow day, you might be the mascot if they don't have enough people. So you have to throw on that costume and get people excited. You were there for sponsorship. I mean, all these different activations you pretty much had a hand in. And it gave you a sense of what you wanted to do, what you didn't want to do as well, and hopefully steer you in the course to help you down the line for your career.
What was your time like as the fan first intern for the green team for the New York Jets?
So that one I actually did for 1 year. I actually found it through my sports management college. I went to St. John's University, and they were looking for a few folks. So we were there every home game. So you're talking, you know, 8 games in a year at that point. And we were there just to work in the upper conference and to pretty much be the voice for the team, to let those folks who are up in the nosebleed sections per se know that they hadn't been forgotten. You know, they might not have been paying thousands of dollars on tickets, but we understand that they were the diehards. So we were there to get them excited. We had autograph sessions. We handed out stickers. We handed out customized pins. So if you were the biggest cheerleader, if you came in costume and we had a game on Halloween, if you were had your face painted, like all these little accolades that you couldn't get anywhere else in the actual arena, the stadium, it was just for those people who were on the upper concourse, just to let them know that, again, we understood that they're the diehards. They're the ones who helped the team. And we wanted to make sure they knew that we knew that they're a part of that bigger picture of helping us be a success.
That's so amazing. What was your time like with the player development as an intern for the Giants?
Oh my gosh, that was the best time ever. So I was there for 6 months, and I actually needed that internship to graduate for that sports management degree at St. John's. I was lucky enough to just circumstances, you know, meet a person who knew a person who got me a foot in the door, and I ended up there, and it was a phenomenal program. I worked with Charles Way, who was the director there, player relations, former player, and Ashley Lynn, who was the manager there and now director there. And we essentially, there are two different parts of it. First and foremost, it was helping those rookies who were transitioning from the college life to the professional life get acclimated to this brand new industry that they're walking into. So helping them in regards to, you know, financial freedom, different scenarios that they might encounter now as a professional, how to handle those situations. If they were interested in perhaps maybe they hadn't graduated before they got drafted, they want to continue that education. giving them the tools that they needed in order to continue that success in the professional and educational world. And then on the back end of that, for those people who were already in the industry and going to be working their way out, at that point back in 2011, the expectancy of a professional athlete in football was 3.6 years. That's 10 years ago, so I don't know what it is at this point. But there were a lot of folks who were already thinking about what that next step in their life was going to be after the professional world, career was over. And so we were there to help get them started. If they did want to pursue, again, in their continuing education, maybe finish that degree, get a master's degree, get a PhD for some of them. If they were interested in mentoring or shadowing, internships, all these programs, giving them the tools that they needed again to get the skills that they needed to be a success in that life after sports. That's what our player development department was. And it was a phenomenal program. I was really excited to be there with them.
What was the transition like for you from going from the NFL to, of course, the MLB with the New York Mets?
I think that's a different question, more so because the biggest difference was the group I was working with. At the player development for the Giants, I was working with the professional athletes, and going over to MLB and guest experience, you're dealing with a much bigger crowd. You're dealing with literally thousands of guests who are coming into the ballpark. You're dealing with hundreds of staff members who are coming into work. So those interactions were very different. And then in player development, I only had to worry about, working with, the vendors that we work with, or the players, different departments as well, but the interactions were much smaller as opposed to on guest experience. I always think of us pretty much as kind of a jack of all trades. Your staff members are the ones who are primarily going to be dealing with every guest that's out there. And for the most part, most of those guests, any staff member that they're going to be interacting with falls under our umbrella, guest experience. So they're going to ask questions about anything or everything. They don't care what your uniform is. They don't care what your job title is. They have a question. They hope you have an answer. So we had to pretty much share information with them about everything going on. If there was a promotional item going on, if there was a parade going on, what the marketing activation was going on, where things were located, group sales redemption, all these little details of every other department. You couldn't just, stay in your lane and just know one thing. You pretty much had to know everything, because our guests are going to be asking everything and you have to know the answer, and we're there to provide them that answer.
What was it like with the New York Mets working with as a fan fest?
So I worked in fan fest for 2 years, 2011 and 2012. And it was phenomenal. It was that foot in the door that I needed to get me started in my career, jumpstart my career. I met some amazing people and I got to know a lot of phenomenal guests as well. You tend to see sometimes the same people over and over again. And so during the course of a season, two seasons, you get to know each other and you grow from there. Here we are, all these years later, and I still keep in touch with a lot of the same season ticket holders that I met back from my days when I was in FanFest. It was a chance to be a part of having a great time at Citi Field, because you were part of, that interaction, that experience that that person was going to have when they come to the game. It's not just watching the game on the field. It was also watching their kids run around Kitty Field or try and get the person in the dunk tank. Every smile on their face, every sticker you handed out, that was part of the bigger message, the bigger picture. And so FanFest was a huge step in getting me jump-started into realizing that I really wanted to work closely with people.
What was your time like as the assistant for the guest experience?
So I was lucky enough after 2 years at FanFest to be hired full-time as the guest experience assistant. And I worked with a phenomenal team. I worked with, you're probably not going to want the call outs, but Craig Marino, Kieran Nolte, Chris Brown, when I first got started. And it was phenomenal. I got the chance to pretty much take the skills that I had learned in all my other jobs and volunteer experiences and translated over to this position. I supervise, that is, our fan greeter staff. And it was simple. I mean, you're literally there just greeting guests as they come in, but you're also, that was always the first line. I don't want to say first line of best. That was the first group of people that a guest would be able to interact with, where they can stay with them for a longer period of time. When a guest was entering, they would go through security, they would get their ticket scanned. Those are quick interactions. But when they came up that escalator and they were interacting with that fan greeter, that was the first time that they could actually, during the course of that entry, be able to have a long discussion. And again, I met some great people. I worked with a close team on our fan greeter staff, worked with them for years, and was able to see their success and be a part of some fringe programming that we had in our department as well.
During your time as the guest experience, what were some of the experiences you had and some of the questions that you were like, whoa?
I would say it depended on the situation, quite honestly. For prime example, ask any person in baseball what the most, I don't want to say difficult, what the most trying times could be. Odds are they're probably going to say like a promotional giveaway, more especially if it's a bobblehead. It is absolutely unbelievable how crazy a person will get over a bobblehead. I mean, people would, if it started at 7 o'clock, the gates would open at 5:10. People would be lined up from 11 o'clock in the morning, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock. The gates weren't opening for like another 5 to 7 hours, and they were there lined up because they wanted it. And people got excited to the point where you're like, folks, calm down. It's all right. It's still going to be there. Those days in particular, especially if it was going to a limited number, when you ran out, those were some trying days. But you get through it. Again, you work with a close team. I mean, you're working with the colleagues in your department, you're working with security, you're working with ticketing, you're working with staff members who are going to be dealing with these guests as well. And so you grow together, you laugh about it, and then you move on to the next game. So those were some of the more, you know, trying days. Different questions that I get, it all depended on the day, really. I mean, people want to know what the promo item is. If there's a rain delay, when is the game going to start? If we had Bark in the Park, where are they entering the ballpark so that way they can head onto the field to walk their dog around the park, on the field, that is. And there are all these different questions, all depend on the day, the time, and the person coming in as well. You'll be surprised how many of our season ticket holders know the ballpark just as much as you. I mean, you'd be a fan assistant and a guest would come over and ask a question. And before that staff member could even answer the question, there's a guest right next to them answering the question too, because they've been there just as long as you. So they know everything. So it's nice to have that connection.
Of course, going back to whenever you were talking about the bobblehead, have you experienced whenever things like that happens where you do run out? What happens whenever you run out and you do have fans? How are you supposed to make them happy, but then you can't because obviously the bobbleheads are out?
So here's the thing. If there's one thing that we're really good at, it's communication. Odds are you were going to actually run out more times than not. So in previous years at City Field, we had promotional items, more specifically the bobbleheads. They went to the first, we changed it. So it went from 15,000, we actually up to 25,000. That was, I'm not sure what it is right now, because I'm not there, but it would go up to 25,000. Once you hit that 25,000 mark, unfortunately, you can't do anything more than that because you can't pull something out of thin air. You know, I couldn't tell, you know, when first thing came up, you're like, well, I was 25,001. Unfortunately, there were 25,000 more people who got here before you. I wish that I can pull out a bobblehead and give it to everyone. But unfortunately, I can't do that to the next person. And it's not fair. It wouldn't be fair to anybody else after. What we did give is we couldn't give them that actual bobblehead, but there are always options. At our team store, we did sell bobbleheads. Now, was it the exact same one that was given out at the door, at the gates? No, it wasn't. But at least they know that if they wanted another one, and sometimes the ones in the team store, you know, they were really cool too. They did have another place to go to see if there's something there that appealed to them.
What was your transition like from going from obviously the NFL to MLB to now working with the NHL with the New Jersey Devils?
Well, we're going to find out, aren't we? So I have been at this new position now. This is actually my third week And for me, I would say the biggest thing, quite honestly, is just terminology. You know, I was in baseball for 10 years. And so all the phrases that I know that I've been used to, I now pretty much have to just throw wayside. I don't know how many times I've caught myself saying ballpark. Well, it's not a ballpark, it's an arena now. Or I've said the field. I'm like, well, no, it's the ice or the floor, because we have both hockey and we have basketball and concerts and such like that. Our sections are not sections, they're vomitoriums and this, I mean, all these different terminologies that I have to get used to. So that's really the biggest thing. That and a brand new different set of people that I've been working with. You know, I was lucky enough to have a great retention rate when I was at Citi Field. So a lot of the people who I started working with back in 2013, when I was hired full-time, were the same people that are still there to this very day. And now I've gone from, you know, working with those same people to having a brand new team. So just a matter of, you know, reworking a few things and saying, all right, starting from scratch, that's fine. Where do we start? Just jumping right on in. That's really it. You know, sports all across the board, even though they are different things that are happening on the field or on their court or on the, you know, ice and such like that, the logistics, the operation side of it, they're all very much the foundation of it is the same. There are just a few tweaks here and there. So just a matter of getting used to learning those tweaks and getting used to them.
What is the transition like from now learning to have where whenever you were with baseball, you had this time where you had off, but now with working in basketball and ice hockey, you don't have that time really of, oh, next season comes.
It's weird. So this is actually the first summer I've had off in 10 years, and it's very strange. But one thing about the Prudential Center is, even though I'm not working, you know, the baseball schedule, there are so many other events that are going on. So at, you know, Citi Field, we did have the 81 home games. We did have we had a few concerts, really great concerts. And we had other miscellaneous events. Here at Prudential Center, we're pretty much an all year round venue. So it'll be not a few concerts, it's gonna be a lot more concerts, a lot more events, such as graduations. We've got festivals and this, that, and other things for me to learn. And all that really does is that it's just something, just a change of pace. You know, there's so many, again, foundations of all these events are the same. It's just the event itself is different. And so just something different to do and something else to keep me engaged.
With working with guests and fans, how have you seen where fans of the NHL and NBA are sometimes more passionate than obviously your MLB fans or vice versa?
I don't know if I can answer that question. And I say that more so because I've only been to one game here. And I actually attended essentially like as a fan to see things. I don't know if I can say that they're more passionate, because I don't know if you've ever been to a Mets game or anything like that, but the fans there are pretty passionate too. I mean, any baseball fan is a diehard when you go there. So I don't think it's really passion that per se is going to be different. It's just the team, it's the colors, and it's just the people, really. That's the biggest thing. I would say one thing that is very different for me more so is just the size. You know, NHL arenas are much smaller than baseball. So I'm used to, on the baseball front, we can fit 45,000 people in Citi Field. That includes standing room only tickets. And here at the NHL, you know, it's a much smaller crowd. You're talking about less than half of what we would fit in the Citi Field. So it's a much different crowd. You know, when I hear numbers here, and I'm just like, wow, that's very different. I believe we were at 10% to begin with over here, and 10% over here is much smaller, you know, than what 10% at Citi Field was. So just a matter of looking through a different lens and working out, you know, what's different and what can I still take over from over there to over here.
What is something that you learned now that you didn't know about before you started working in guest relations?
Something that I did not, I don't think, so it's funny, when you say you're going to work in sports, you realize it's going to be busy. You don't realize quite how much time it's going to take up. And that's not a bad thing, because I don't like to be bored. I like to be constantly on the move. It's just a matter of trying to figure out the perfect work-life balance, which we're all trying to do, quite honestly. And it's a lot easier said than done, but it's just a matter of really focusing on it, because if not, I mean, I'll tell you, anyone in this industry, if you don't focus on work-life balance when you work so many hours and so many days, not just, again, the typical Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, you're going to burn out. And you're going to lose your passion for doing the job. So you have to find that balance. Whether it might be just logging off, turning your phone off and not touching it for a day, whether it be going on vacation, reading a book, whatever you need to do to get your mind right and get centered, you have to really focus on it, because if not, it'll be very hard to survive, not just in guest experience, but in the sports industry in general. It's fast paced. So you got to find that work-life balance to ensure that you're still enjoying it in the long run.
What is something that you would advise somebody that wants to work in professional sports?
The biggest advice I have, if there's one thing that I feel like has helped me in my, you know, my journey, I would say is the fact that when I first got started, I didn't say no to anything. I volunteered at so many different events. So I volunteered at WISE, Women in Sports and Events, Women in Sports and, yeah, and Events, at their galas. And it was, WISE is an industry organization that is women from different sports teams, organizations, leagues, industries coming together to network. They had a gala. They said they needed people assist. I said, sure, why not? I'll volunteer. I volunteered at the one day like NBA draft, which actually happened to be a Prudential Center, and that was back in 2010. They needed people to assist with some of the activations that were taking place on the outside concourse. So I was there helping kids shoot basketballs, passing them this, giving them that. One day event for 5 hours, I lost nothing, but I made connections. Boomer Esiason Foundation, that was through sport, St. John's. They reached out to them and said, hey, we're looking for a couple people to assist at their gala that's going on. I said, sure, why not? It's one night. Went there, and Boomer Esiason in general, former football player for the New York Jets, his son suffered from cystic fibrosis, has a huge gala. And because he knew so many people in the industry, the number of people who actually were assisting and volunteering on the back end were people who worked at the New York Jets and every other professional sports team. So just like that, in that one day, I made so many connections. And it's just because I said yes. Yes to going there for 5 hours in one day and assisting. And it's those little things that in the long run help you, because A, enough people see you, they get to know you and they recognize you. B, the sports world is a very small industry. So odds are, if you know one person, then they know this person, who knows that person, who knows that person, who knows you. And before you know it, your name is known, not just that one person, but throughout an entire industry. You got to start somewhere, but it also just starts from just saying yes to every little opportunity, every little thing that seems small in the long run can help you in your goal down the line to help you in your future.
That's wonderful advice. Where can my listeners find you at on social media?
So I'm on LinkedIn. So if you, my name is, again, Ezinne Nwagu, Ezinne Nwagu. Reach out to me, connect with me. I have a lot of people who reach out to me just, you know, get advice, even to have me read their resume. And I have said, sure, why not? Because I remember what it's like on the back end when I was looking to get started and I wanted a little assistance and advice. So I'm happy to help. And I hope folks will reach out to you so I can connect with them.
Thank you again, Ezinne Nwagu, for your interview. And best of luck in your future, wherever it may hold you.
Thank you. I appreciate it, Brandon.
You can find Brandon Sports Talk on Facebook at Brandon Sports Talk, Instagram at Brandon Sports Talk, Twitter at @talk_Brandon, and you can find me on YouTube at Brandon Sports Talk. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Thank you again for your interview, and best of luck.
Thank you.
You've been watching Brandon Sports Talk. Please feel free to like, share, and subscribe to Brandon Sports Talk on social media and on YouTube.